Remember I told you about the garments of Jesus? And we saw in some places the garment, and you saw the string that coming. So this is the string of the garment that made of 8 pieces, that one of them always painted with light blue. Light blue, not a dark blue. By the way, you don't see the word blue in the Bible nowhere. Whenever you look at the Bible, you don't find the word blue, you find the word light blue. Light blue, the color of sky. So the dark blue, it's a light blue. And this is the color of God. And that's what the color on the string, on the garments, is the color of God. And we just found, not long time ago, the seashell, the real one, that in the time of Jesus, the time of the temple, they used to make the light blue color from that seashell. So, according to the scriptures and the prophets, when we're going to complete finding the blue and the red cow, the real red cow, we can make the red apple, then we are on the way for the third temple to become. So we are not far away from that moment anymore. So as we're sailing on the lake, look on the left hand side, you see the city of Tiberia, which was called Rakat in King Solomon's time. The name Tiberia was given by one of the grandsons of King Herod, that he decided to show his loyalty to the Romans, and he called it on the name of Caesar Tiberius, which was the Caesar in the time that Pontius Pilate sent Jesus to his death. Looking to the other side, there's a big cliff. Take a look, at 11 o'clock, 10 o'clock, it's a big cliff. This mount over there called Mount Arbel. In Jesus' time, the life of the Jewish under the Roman was very bad life. And the Jews went to the war against the Romans, and about 750 Jewish people, women, children, all came to the cliff over there, hiding themselves in the caves and fighting against the Romans. And then the Romans blocked the mount and offered the people to surrender. But the people sent a message to King Herod and said, "You are not better from your grandfather, and we don't trust you, and we prefer to die than not to fall to your hands." And all those families actually jumped from the cliff down to the bottom and killed themselves because they refused to fall in love to the hand of those Romans, knowing what anyway going to be the punishment of these Romans. On the right hand side of us, unfortunately, it's not very clear this morning, but that's where the Golan Heights. The Golan Heights, my dear friends, in 1967 was part of Syria, and for over 20 years, the Syrians was bombing, shooting, attacking Israel daily, sometimes twice a day, sometimes even 3 times a day. Israel complained for years to the United Nations to stop the shootings, but the United Nations, it's the United Nations, or the way we have a nickname to them, we call them United Nothing. We couldn't do nothing about it. And in 1967, Israel decided to get rid of the Syrians, and we took the Golan Heights from the Syrians. And I must tell you that since 1967 till today, it was not even one shooting from that direction down to Israel. So it's proved itself. It's proved itself. Let me tell you something off the record. The national law saying very clearly that when you have a war between two countries, and the one that was the first one to attack and he losing land, the one that took the land from him doesn't have to give it back. If you are the first one to attack and you take land from those ones that you attack, you must give the land back. That's simply the national law about all that. The question is, did the Golan Heights ever was part of Syria? And the answer is no. Because in Jesus' time, the Golan Heights was definitely part of the Kingdom of Israel. We have over 36 Jewish cities in the Golan Heights in the time of Jesus. And matter of fact, one of the most important Jewish historians ever lived, the one that wrote the most important Jewish books about the Jewish history, Josephus Flavius, who was a Jewish commander of the Golan Heights during the war against the Romans. So here we are, folks, we're sailing on this sea. When you feel the wind blowing on your face and on your body, I want you to think only about one thing. When you read the Old Testament, and you read the book of Genesis, and you read over there about how God created earth and created the sky and separated the sky from earth and separated the sea above from the sea down below us, it's ending in saying, and the Holy Spirit of God floating on the water. As a child, I didn't know what this meant, but in my childhood imagination, which I had a very good imagination as a child, I could see the wind that having kind of a weird face blowing on the water. And the first time in my life that I came to visit the Sea of Galilee, I was about 16 years old, and I was sitting here on a little boat, one of those fishermen boats, because there was no priest boat at that time, and one of the fishermen gave me a ride, and I was sitting in his boat, and he was busy with his nets catching fish, and I was sitting there and just looking, and I felt the wind in my body. The moment that I felt the wind in my body, it hit me like a blitz, and I thought to myself, God is touching me. The Holy Spirit, the Holy Wind of God floating in the water. So now we feel the wind in our body, and I feel that God is touching us, putting his finger on each one of us. So I'd like to welcome you, all of you, coming to the Sea of Galilee. And Daniel and his team are not just the sailors. They're very special people. But I let Daniel to talk about himself, and I let Daniel to explain who he is and what it's all about. And then Daniel, which is a very, very good singer, is going to play for us with his best friends over there, to play the instruments, and they're going to sing for us. And then we're going to dance in the middle of the boat.